Get up. Joel, get up. Please stop. Please don't shoot. Joel, please get up. No!
Abby! Step up! You're torturing me!
Abby has single-handedly ruined this game.
The Last of Us Part 2 is... divisive?
This game didn't resonate the way it intended for everybody, which I attribute to its subversion of the traditional storytelling formula in service of the exploration of contradicting characters. Whether you agree with that remains to be seen, but its promotion of such strong opinions makes for an interesting case study.
My intention with this analysis is to shed light in a way I haven't seen other creators interpret, or at least discuss, The Last of Us Part 2.
Spoilers.
A couple of parentheses before we begin.
I'm not going to analyse gameplay mechanics because I don't find them interesting to talk about. Yes, I have tested out the gameplay, and as expected, it develops the core mechanics of the original.
I like the difference between the characters. The agility of Ellie and strength of Abby intuitively makes the player attuned to their playstyles. Overall, if you like the gameplay of the first game, then chances are you're going to like it here too. Part 2's thematic core is not concerned with revenge. There's a revenge plot present, but it's consciously used to mask Part 2's true intentions. What are the game's true intentions?
Well, stick around and I'll tell you, curious viewer.
I've seen the quote. A Japanese fan said it is a story about right and wrong, written by people who think they're always right. I cannot find any citation, so I doubt its validity. But again, this is simply wrong, because commentary on violence and perspective does not correlate with being lectured on what is right and wrong, particularly when it comes to a game that places a lot of emphasis on separating character from player.
If hearing those caveats haven't immediately made you dislike and click off the video, then welcome to the channel, and I hope
to keep you entertained and informed for the next
108
minutes. To understand the intent of Part 2, you have to acknowledge the type of story the media is wanting to tell, which I perceive to be an extension of director Neil Druckmann's trademark writing style.
Simple stories, complex characters. And yes, that's how it should be.
It's important to clarify the position Part 2 situates itself, in that this is not a plot-driven game like the original, it is a character-driven game. And that's a rare trait for a AAA video game to possess, as they often pride themselves on setting plot-orientated objectives that the player must instinctively complete.
A man chooses, a slave obeys.
I stress this point because it informs my perspective of the game, and in turn dictates that the focus of this video essay will be on character, not story. So here's the weather forecast for today, and while it is true that this video is quite long, I did take the time to timestamp each section. But before we can begin, I'd like to thank our sponsor of the video. I'm just joking. I'll just be providing a briefish summary of the first game and a more detailed summary of the second game that takes up
5,000 words of this script. For those of you who either avoided the leaks, need a refresher, or have tried to forget the ensuing PTSD.
The first Last of Us is centered around the developing relationship between Joel, a smuggler struggling with the pain of losing his daughter, and Ellie, a lively 14-year-old who is believed to be the only person immune to the society-crippling cordyceps fungus 20 years after its outbreak.
Oh, that's nasty.
The player controls Joel as he's forced into spending a year guiding Ellie across a barren America, their destination being a hospital owned by a militia group called the Fireflies. Ellie was close with Firefly leader Marlene, whose intention is to use Ellie to create a vaccine and re-stabilize the world. She tasks Joel and his smuggling partner Tess to escort Ellie out of the Boston quarantine zone and meet a convoy that would take her the rest of the way. Unfortunately, the convoy are decimated and Tess is killed after being bitten by infected, leaving Ellie in Joel's care. The pair seek out nearby acquaintance Bill to scrounge a car, before traveling through a hunter-run Pittsburgh and heading towards Jackson, Wyoming to find Joel's brother Tommy, a former Firefly who Joel believes to know where the hospital would be. Along the way, he protects Ellie from the infected and humans who want to turn them into tomato soup. Upon arriving to Jackson, the pair find Tommy and his wife Maria have begun to form a small settlement that hopes to live something akin to pre-outbreak, utilizing a hydroelectric dam situated nearby. The interior conflict stems from Joel's reluctancy to care for Ellie, not wanting to relive the trauma of losing somebody he loves, while Ellie starts to see him as the father and protector she never had. His secret plan had been to dump Ellie with Tommy and let him take her to the hospital, but he changes his mind after this standout scene.
Not her, you know.
What?
Maria told me about Sarah.
Ellie! And... you are treading on some mighty thin ice here.
I'm sorry about your daughter, Joel, but I have lost people too.
You have no idea what loss is.
Everyone I have cared for has either died or left me. Everyone except for you. So don't tell me that I would be safer with someone else, because the truth is I would just be more scared.
His staunch rejection of embrace slowly subsides as they spend more time together, progressively trusting her as she's allowed to wield a gun and eventually forced to care for him after he is impaled during a fight. In this time, we see Ellie become savvier as she scavenges supplies and holds her own against David, an initially friendly group leader who later captures and attempts to groom her. Ellie manages to escape, distracting David by telling him she's infected, and violently murders him after a stealthy confrontation. The final part of the game sees the pair barely make it to the hospital in Salt Lake City, both being dragged in unconscious. Here, Joel is reunited with Marlene, where she tells him that Ellie must be killed to create a vaccine, and that they'd already prepped the surgery without hers or Joel's consultancy.
I get it. But whatever it is you think you're going through right now is nothing to what I have been through. I knew her since she was born. I promised your mother I would look after her.
Then why are you letting this happen?
Because this isn't about me, or even her. There is no other choice here.
After some consideration, Joel grabs his supplies and massacres his way through the hospital until reaching a still unconscious Ellie in the operating room. He murders the lead neurosurgeon before taking Ellie and escaping into a parking lot, ending his wrath by killing Marlene. Once Ellie awakens, Joel lies to her and says the Fireflies have stopped looking for a cure after finding more immune people like her. She skeptically reacts to his story. The epilogue sees them return to Jackson, where Ellie once again questions Joel on the events at the hospital. He reiterates his lie, the game ending with this inconclusive and now iconic moment.
Swear to me. Swear to me that everything that you said about the Fireflies is true.
I swear.
Okay.
While the ending received lavish praise for its execution, debates sprung up online questioning the morality of Joel's decision to rob the world a chance to finally overcome this pandemic.
Abby, I swear to God, if you catch this one too.
Part 2 starts with Joel cleaning his newfound guitar, telling Tommy about the events at the hospital. He is stunned but promises to keep the truth a secret. He then goes to see Ellie, attempting to relieve her emotional distance by fulfilling her wish to hear him sing.
Well, when I was a kid, I used to want to be a singer.
Shut up.
No, serious.
Sing something.
No.
Come on, I won't laugh.
He gives her the guitar before leaving, promising to teach her how to play. 4 years pass and we're shown a thriving Jackson, with the game focusing on Ellie's relationship to Jesse and his ex-girlfriend Dina, whom she kissed at a social event the night before. After sharing some initial awkwardness...
You wanna f*** him up?
the women are sent on patrol together, with Jesse mentioning that Joel left for his patrol earlier that morning. We then cut to a snowy lodge and are introduced to Abby. She's led out the lodge by Owen, going along a path that establishes her fear of heights until reaching a view of Jackson. We infer that the group are looking for somebody, and that Abby and Owen had prior intimacy. Owen's apprehensive at the settlement size, but Abby remains resolute, and after hearing Owen's partner Mel is pregnant, pushes forward alone to a Jackson outpost. Ellie and Dina go about their patrol route. Bad weather forces the pair into a nearby library where they discover a secret weed farm. The pair light a spliff, and things get a little heated. Abby heads towards the outpost while outrunning a horde. She's briefly subdued by infected but is saved by Joe and Tommy. The group attempt to fight off the horde before deciding to evacuate. Upon hearing the pair's names, Abby suggests they should retreat to her lodge. Ellie shows Dina her bite mark and confides her immunity, now hidden by a chemical burn and moth tattoo. Dina refuses to believe her, but is interrupted by Jesse bursting in, telling them that Joe and Tommy haven't returned from their patrol. Now worried, Ellie states they should split up and search for them. Joe, Tommy and Abby escape the horde and make it back to her lodge. They're welcomed by the traveling group until this moment.
I'm Mel, by the way.
Tommy. This is my brother.
Joe. Y'all act like you heard of us or something.
Because they have.
Quick aside, this scene is harrowing to watch, but I really admire the direction of the cutscenes in part 2. Scenes that are one take make us feel like we're a part of the moment, giving us the impression that we can intervene in the character struggle. But scenes that cut more frequently disassociate us from the video game interactivity and subconsciously ask us to view the character building moments from an outsider's perspective. Ellie sees the lodge and is instantly suspicious. She sneaks inside and hears Joel's screams coming from the basement. Dashing towards him, she peers through the door and sees his mangled body.
Get her down!
Get off me!
Get her hands!
Get the f*** off me!
You got her! Look, you got her! Okay?
You're gonna fucking die!
Get up. Joel, get up. Please stop. Please don't shoot. Joel, please get up. No!
Joel, our playable character from the first game, is mercilessly killed by someone the player spent the briefest of time with. His death is the inciting incident that will set the narrative of part 2 into motion. Ellie and Tommy discuss the need for revenge. She is insistent on traveling to Seattle and killing everybody involved with Joel's death. Tommy tries to be more measured, but ultimately ends up going to Seattle alone, leaving a note asking Maria to stop Ellie and Dina from following. She realistically knows that won't be possible, and lets the pair take a horse.
When he comes back.
Here starts Ellie's 3-day journey through a crumbling Seattle. They reach the tall walls of Seattle's abandoned quarantine zone, maneuvering through the ruins until reaching a gate that requires fuel to pass, forcing the pair to investigate the large downtown area. Here the player is given the option for extra exploration, with the plot only requiring Ellie to explore the courthouse and a synagogue where Dina talks about her late sister. Extra areas include a secret revolution base, a bank with an Uncharted Easter egg, and a music store with an optional cutscene where Ellie sings a cover of Take On Me. There are notes and locations alluding to the military's ousting in a coup d'etat staged by the Washington Liberation Front, also known as the Wolves, the group whose badges were imprinted onto the jackets of Joel's killers. They spend most of day one investigating the city. In order, this includes finding the body of somebody present for Joel's death in a position reminiscent of a torture method he used to verify information, suggesting their mutilation had come by Tommy's hands. Ellie getting captured by the Wolves and then killing the guy whose face she'd previously scarred, heading to a TV station, finding multiple paintings of an elegant woman with scars along the way, before discovering a slew of disemboweled dead bodies at the station.
This is definitely not Tommy.
did this. I don't know.
Here she also finds Polaroids of all the wolves present at Jackson, her face filled with anguish when seeing a picture of Abby. They then escape through an abandoned subway to outmaneuver the wolves.
Fucking meow!
We see Dina show greater fatigue, coupled with her earlier sickness that rings concerning bells. Ellie then falls off a subway car, breaking her mask and frightening Dina.
Here, we can share mine.
No, 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 no! Don't get it off! Dina,
Ellie, stop! Ellie, stop!
What?
No!
Ellie, no!
Stop! I'm not infected! I'm immune!
They outrun the infected and take shelter in a nearby theater, continuing their conversation.
You want to tell me what's going on with you?
What's going on with me? Ellie, I just saw you breathe spores.
I can't get you infected if that's what you worry about. Can you say something?
I think I'm pregnant.
Ellie doesn't take this news well, leaving Dina to rest and finding a guitar when exploring the theater. This leads into her first flashback sequence. For Ellie's birthday, she's taken to a dinosaur and space museum by Joel, harkening back to a relationship similar to the first game.
Look at me! I'm on a motherfucking dinosaur!
The sequence ends with Ellie finding the memoirs of a former Firefly who went insane. Their reaction shows they still haven't resolved the tension surrounding the hospital. Ellie wakes to see Dina has been using a radio to listen to the WLF. She attempts to apologize for last night, but is interrupted by a report of a lone male trespasser, matching the description of Tommy. Ellie tells Dina to remain at the theater while she goes to find him. Dina gives her the hamster bracelet. Day 2 extends the world with the remnants of stories from previous residents, with a leader called Isaac mentioned in various locations. Ellie searches for Tommy, battling against the wolves until she stumbles across a wounded familiar face.
What the hell are you doing here?
I think I'd let you do this on your own.
This reveal was replaced by Joe in the trailers and was subject to some controversy we'll address later. The pair reunite with Dina. She tends to Jesse's wounds while Ellie awkwardly watches from a distance, transitioning into another flashback. Ellie is out shooting with Tommy, testing out his rifle before meeting up with Joel. Tommy encourages them to spend more time together, setting them the objective to collect new strings for her guitar. Here we see Joel pressuring Ellie to keep her immunity a secret.
I think I see a way through, but we got spores. Put your mask on.
Do I have to? It's just us.
What if we run into someone?
Okay, fine.
They stumble across two deceased teenagers with the note saying they were bitten by infected. This makes Ellie again ask him about the Fireflies, feeling guilty that her immunity can't help others. Joel brushes off her concern and continues to uphold his lie, despite Ellie's obvious suspicion and frustration. Ellie heads to the WLF hospital upon finding out Nora, one of Joel's killers, has been sent there on a supply run. In her journey, I was even able to cheat the game. If you know, you know. Here, Ellie has her first skirmish with the Seraphites, a primal faction that opposes the WLF and were the ones responsible for the paintings and TV station massacre. They call to each other through whistles and bear sycoraxes across their faces, giving them the derogatory term scars by the wolves. Ellie struggles but survives her fight with them, making it to the hospital. She slowly progresses through the base, ambling along a vent until finding her target. Ellie confronts Nora, who, let's say, puts her head into the mouth of the lion.
Yeah. Yeah, that little bitch got what he deserved.
You fucking... Trespasser!
A chase ensues, which leads to Ellie throwing herself and Nora into a spore pit. They share a brief exchange before Ellie, controlled by the player, begin to torture her for Abby's location.
You're breathing spores. Her.
Firefly?
There are no Fireflies anymore.
Ellie is shaken about what she's had to do in service of her vendetta, but she does receive the information required, knowing Abby is hiding out in the aquarium by a Ferris wheel. Dina comforts her, with Ellie uttering, "I don't want to lose you," before leading into another flashback. Ellie explores the now-abandoned Firefly Hospital, walking along the same corridor from the first game. She finds a tape recorder that highlights her unique immunity and proof that Joel lied to her. Upon finding her, Ellie furiously asks him to tell the truth, threatening not to go back to Jackson. Knowing he's been exposed, Joel begrudgingly reveals his heinous actions, with Ellie breaking down upon hearing the revelation.
Don't you touch me! I'll go back. But we're done.
Ellie finds Jesse tending a sleeping Dina, whose condition has significantly regressed through the night, with Jesse intuitively working out she's pregnant. He wants to head back to Jackson so she can receive proper treatment, but Ellie says she feels responsible for Tommy and couldn't leave Seattle without him. Jesse concludes they should head to Abby's location and wait for him there. The pair traverse Seattle together.
Now that's a lot of damage!
From their conversations, we infer that Jesse still has underlying feelings for Dina, placing her protection as paramount importance, and querying Ellie on why she didn't tell him about their unborn child. I haven't seen many people make this point, but it's clear he wouldn't have travelled to Seattle by himself to avenge Joel like he says, and that was before he knew Dina was pregnant. They hear reports of a sniper at the marina, a description that almost certainly has to be Tommy. When Jesse suggests going to the marina, Ellie's true intentions come to light.
He can take care of himself.
Jesus Christ.
The best way to help Tommy is to go after Abby. You do this, I'm not saving your ass again.
I really hope you make it.
She continues alone, stealing a boat and negotiating the rough waters. The night beckons as her boat capsizes within a stone's throw of the shore leading to the Ferris wheel. Pushed by her trauma and thirst for revenge, Ellie reaches the aquarium, only to find it absent of life. This is until a vent she's crawling through buckles, creating a loud bang that doesn't go unheard. She reaches the end of a hallway and pries through the door to see Owen and Mel arguing. Ellie intervenes and holds them at gunpoint, interrogating them on Abby's location while attempting to use the same technique as Joel from the first game. Despite Mel's willingness to give up her location, the cross-examination does not go as Ellie would have hoped. Quickly realizing her harrowing actions puts Ellie into a state of shock. She hears a voice that eerily resembles Joel's, making her recoil and point her gun at an encroaching figure.
Whoa, 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 whoa! Hey! Hey! It's all right.
Unfortunately, in her anguish, she forgets to collect the map that's guided her for the past 3 days. Ellie lays next to a sleeping Dina, caressing her pale face as the guys plan a route back to Jackson. She meets them by the stage, resentful that Abby gets to survive, but accepting of the need to travel back. Tommy heads to the lobby, with Ellie and Jesse sharing one final heart-to-heart.
Jesse, stand up! Hands in the air, I shoot this one too!
Don't you do it, Ellie. Get out of here.
Stand up.
Ellie knows she's outmatched and surrenders to her nemesis.
I know why you killed Joel. He did what he did to save me. There is no cure because of me. I am the one that you want. Just let him go.
You killed my friends. We let you both live. And you wasted it.
And then the perspective abruptly flips, the player not yet realizing they're only halfway through the experience, with the narrative continuing in the control of Abby.
This is big.
She converges with her father, jovially talking about her relationship with Owen while tracking a zebra.
And he makes you laugh.
That's because he's such an idiot.
They catch up to the animal, finding it caught on a barbed wire fence. Now joined by Owen, they save the cat and follow it until reunited with its foal. A picturesque view of the Salt Lake City Hospital lingers in the background as Owen tells the pair of the arrival of an immune girl. The player then realizes Abby's father is the lead neurosurgeon, followed by a sense of dreaded inevitability with the knowledge of their hapless demise on the horizon.
Is he still in the building?
Is that...
Abby.
No!
Abby, don't look!
Dad! Dad! No! No!
No! Owen holds her back from Jerry's lifeless corpse as the game smash cuts to Joel's death, now carrying a level of ambivalence.
Joel, get up! Please stop! Please don't shoot! Joel, please get up! No! No! No!
Bring help, pendejo.
Kill you!
Whoa, whoa, what are you doing? Manny!
Cleaning up.
No, no, no. We're here for him. That's it.
Stop!
We're done.
The story is then reset, returning to Seattle Day 1. Abby is startled by Manny, who's been doing some extracurricular activities.
Hello, Miss Potts.
They travel through the WLF base, collecting supplies for a journey to the FOB. They're joined by Alice and Mel, who's now deep into her pregnancy. There is tension between Mel and Abby, stemming from her disapproval of the way she killed Joe. On the way there, Mel reveals that Owen has been distant for the past few weeks, with Abby emulating the same impression. They're then ambushed by the Seraphites and crash the vehicle, being forced to duck into a nearby warehouse. Slowly making their way on foot, they're eventually saved by fellow wolves. Mel injures her shoulder during the fight, and after nurturing the wound, Abby is finally able to show some compassion for her.
Hey. You did all right back there. It's almost a compliment.
Go get help.
Abby and Manny are led into the morgue and shown the dead body of Owen's last assignment partner. This scares Abby, confounded by Isaac's decision to not send a search party. She then meets him in the WLF prison, his authority felt in the politer demeanor used by the soldiers. Isaac briefs them on a planned assault against the Seraphite Islands to hopefully end their tiresome war, employing the cover of a storm due in a couple days. Abby mentions Owen, but Isaac sternly denies her request to search for him. Yet a lack of consent doesn't stop her, looking towards the Ferris wheel before transitioning it into a flashback. Owen playfully rocks a Ferris wheel cart while Abby holds on tight, reiterating her fear of heights. She talks about not wanting to miss training, which Owen reacts to by jumping off the wheel and into the sea below. He gives her a whistle-stop tour of the aquarium, discovering a sailboat while Abby expresses her disdain for the Seraphites. They finish in an underwater dome, sharing a moment of embrace before Abby pulls away with trauma overcoming her.
I know all the leads have dried up, but... the Joel's still out there, you know?
I know.
She goes to training, leaving him alone in the aquarium. In the present day, Abby heads to the aquarium, following the warm sunset as she avoids Seraphites and infected alike. Wandering into a camp, she's eventually captured by the cult, another flashback being triggered. Abby unannouncedly visits Owen at the aquarium, who's been dating Mel for a year. She tells him they have a lead on Tommy's location, with the whole crew prepared to travel to Jackson. He subtly disapproves about going. Abby has a close shave with Death, but is saved by two Seraphite siblings being hunted by the group. Yara, the older one, has her arm severely damaged during the escape. Lev mentions they're being targeted because he cut his hair. Abby retrieves her stuff and protects the pair from infected, eventually reaching a business park where she fixes Yara's arm as best she can before leaving. She finds Owen in the sailboat, agitated by his drunk talk of heading to a rumored Firefly regroup in Santa Barbara. He states that he's done fighting, with the conversation getting a little heated before their actions get very heated. That night, Abby has a nightmare, running along the hospital hallway until reaching the disemboweled bodies of her Seraphite saviors. She travels back to the business park the next day. Abby returns to see Yara's condition has significantly exasperated. She's taken back to the aquarium where she's examined by Mel, bearing bad news that her arm needs to be amputated and the supplies required for the operation aren't accessible. To everyone's surprise, Abby agrees on following Lev across a Seraphite trail to the hospital, needing to move quickly if Yara is to survive. Owen collars her as she leaves.
Look, she just showed up.
Okay.
I don't think she knows about last night.
I don't care about last night.
Well, I do.
The journey takes them increasingly higher, with Seraphites using bridges to get around the city. During their climb, they're attacked by a small group who address Lev by a different name, alluding to his transgender origins.
Did you hear what they called me?
Yeah.
Do you want to ask me about it?
Do you want me to ask you about it?
No.
Okay.
Abby's fears intensify as they cross the tall bridges, with Lev initially attempting to comfort her through the words of his prophet.
Only when weak may I carry my true strength.
And then by adding levity.
What's going on between you and your friend Owen?
Oh my god, Lev, now?
It seemed really awkward.
Just go!
Hang on, levity? Lev? Oh. Despite falling off near the end, Abby prevails over her fears and they make it to the hospital. With most hospital supplies already moved to the FOB, Abby is forced to investigate Ground Zero, the untouched floors where the first infected patients were brought. Navigating the infected and turning the power on, she eventually finds the supplies before being attacked by a new adversary. After throwing about 80 pipe bombs, Abby slays the monster, reunites with Lev, and steals a boat heading back to the aquarium. Yara's surgery is successful, and that night Abby has the same dream of running down the hallway, only now to see her father smiling at the end. Abby wakes to the sounds of Lev and Yara arguing over going to save their mum. The former is worried that she will be reprimanded by the Seraphites for her association, the latter stating she would have already disowned them due to her loyalty. Abby bumps into a frustrated Mel, who vents some misconstrued anger.
You absolute leech!
Yara consoles her as they search for an infuriated Lev, only to be horrified as they see him pilot the boat towards the island. With their sailboat not yet fixed, Abby and Yara head to the marina to find a way across. Owen asserts on joining them, but Abby again shrugs him off.
I'm not gonna let her go by herself.
Actually, you are.
I can help.
Yeah, by staying here and fixing the sailboat. Get your priorities straight.
Hearing gunshots, Abby moves ahead and bumps into Manny, who's been hunting a sniper that's had the marina on lockdown. They avoid his eyeline and make their way to his location, believing to have him cornered until... Tommy is bested by Abby and Yara, who then take a boat and head to the island. They traverse the Seraphite's homeland, their destination being Levin Yara's former hut. Bells start ringing as the Seraphites prepare for battle against the wolves, with Abby witnessing the full extent of Isaac's invasion. Thunder is distantly heard as they reach the hut, discovering the bloody corpse of their mother.
Oh, thank God. Did she do this? I just tried talking to her. I tried to make her understand.
You were defending yourself. You did nothing wrong.
Hearing the fight begin, Abby picks up the bow and hands it to him. They sneak across the island, avoiding the fighting and heading towards the docks to evacuate. That is until they encounter Isaac's battalion.
Got one!
Nora!
Abby?
Stay back!
Drop it! Now!
Oh. It's Abby! Stay back!
Stand down!
Yara is shot and Abby resiliently defends Lev from the wolf leader. His sister's last action saves them by shooting Isaac and allowing an escape. There are heavy consequences to the war, with countless soldiers being slaughtered in a haunting horseback sequence. They make it to the docks and escape the island relatively unscathed, heading back to the aquarium. Nearing the convergence point of the two protagonists, the player knows an abhorrent sight awaits their return. Using Ellie's map, they locate and quietly enter the theater. Events are reshown, and a resolution is offered to Ellie's cliffhanger.
I know why you killed Joel. He did what he did to save me. There is no cure because of me. I am the one that you want. Just let him go.
You killed my friends. We let you both live.
And you wasted it!
Wait!
Get off of her! Mommy! Come on!
Abby chases Ellie through the theater and, with the player controlling her, must fight Ellie until she is gravely wounded.
Nothing to do with this. She's pregnant.
Good.
Abby.
Bringing both protagonists' journey in Seattle to a close. Ellie, Dina, and now baby JJ live in a peaceful farmhouse, maintaining a life divorced from the horror of Seattle. Ellie cares for JJ, spending a moment gazing at the beguiling sunsets before tending their livestock. She's then hit by a sudden panic attack, still suffering from Joel's death and subverting their paradisic presentation. Dina does her best to comfort her. They're visited by a somehow still living Tommy, who informs them of Abby's location, spotted living in a beach sailboat in Santa Barbara. Ellie is quiet but rejects his proposal to hunt her after seeing Dina's seething reaction. The pair furiously argue as he leaves, with Ellie holding JJ while looking down at his map. During the night, Ellie sneaks downstairs and plays the guitar, having a flashback to her first kiss with Dina and her last public conversation with Joel.
Oh, just what this town needs. Another loudmouth dyke.
What the f*** did you just say?
Ellie,
hey.
Ellie, don't.
Get the hell out of here.
Get your hands off me.
What is wrong with you?
He had no right.
And you do? I don't need your f***ing help, Joel.
Right.
Dina comes downstairs to see Ellie packing her things for Santa Barbara. She fails to persuade her to stay.
You don't owe Tommy anything.
I don't sleep. I don't eat. I'm not like you, Dina.
When she realizes there's no stopping her, she threatens to not do this again, which does little to deter Ellie. The player briefly controls Abby as her and Lev discover an abandoned Firefly outpost. Using a radio, they're able to contact the group who directs them to their main base on Catalina Island. They unfortunately don't make it far, being seized by the Rattlers, a detestable group of slave masters based in the local area. We return to Ellie as she discovers Abby's boat, a letter mentioning Owen proving it to be hers. She progresses through Santa Barbara until getting caught in a Rattler trap and severely injuring herself. Once the slavers cut her down, Ellie uses her immunity to get out of their captivity.
I think there were actually a few coronavirus patients, and I shook hands with everybody, you'll be pleased to know, and I continue to shake hands.
Hearing Ellie mention Abby, the other slaver attempts to save himself by disclosing the location of their camp. This ends as well as you'd expect. Ellie heads to the camp and does what all good Last of Us protagonists do. She finds Abby at the Pillars, the place where disobedient prisoners are sent and left to die. Cutting her down, Abby then frees Lev and shows Ellie to the boats. Putting her stuff away, she challenges Abby to a final duel. When she refuses, Ellie threatens an incapacitated Lev, forcing her to fight. Their struggle is dirty and uncoordinated, with Abby removing two of Ellie's fingers. But eventually Ellie pins her down, finally able to kill someone who's inflicted an untold amount of pain on her. But she lets her live, allowing Abby to take the boat to Catalina Island. Ellie quietly returns to the farmhouse, finding it empty and abandoned, her stuff thrown into a closed room. She picks up the guitar but is unable to play due to her missing fingers. This transitions into the final flashback, her last conversation with Joel. She tells him to stop being overprotective and shows uncertainty in how to feel about Dina. The conversation then turns as Ellie and Joel finally communicate with each other.
I was supposed to die in that hospital. My life would have mattered. But you took that from me.
If somehow the Lord gave me a second chance at that moment, I would do it all over again.
I don't think I can ever forgive you for that. But I would like to try.
I'd like that.
Ellie places the guitar by the window, picks up her stuff, and leaves the farmhouse. The game draws to a close as the player hopefully contemplates on where she will go next, while reflecting on the journey she has already taken.
So why was that necessary? Well, the lengthened subtlety of Part 2 means that the intended effect can be undermined by the player's memory, which is then accentuated by the influence of social media on interpreting such a diverse story. I just hope this probably too detailed description of events gives you an indication of where my analysis might be going.
I'll start by stating that there are a multitude of logical inconsistencies and conveniences sprinkled throughout the story. Not as many as some people claim, and I don't find them to be as prevalent as the detractors who go looking for them say they are, but this feature is a result of the focus being on character first, story second, with the thematic elements inviting the player to study the story and to understand its complicated subject matters. There is undeniable subtlety here, demonstrated in the resolution to Abby's story being in the menu screen once you've completed the game. We're shown the boat she fled Santa Barbara in beached, with the building described by the Firefly in the background, suggesting that her and Lev made it to Catalina Island. This is supported by its juxtaposition of a despondently presented moored boat in the previous menu screen, although Druckmann forebodingly only confirmed that this is the same boat and not that Abby and Lev made it to the Fireflies.
Just say it. Just say that she made it. It's fine. You know, just... No, no.
So good!
But that subtlety is why I kept returning to this game, how I was able to not only reflect on the decisions of the characters, but my reaction to those decisions as a player. Do you know what my favourite moment of the game was? It might surprise you, but it's this moment here. Okay, well, joint favourite moment. This was the moment where the tension lifted after Abby's chaotic day 3, ending with an emotionally challenging confrontation between the two protagonists, and the first moment where the game allowed me to pause and reflect on the journey taken with these characters and the newfound perspective I discovered along the way. It's easy to get swept up in the violence and destruction of this post-apocalyptic world. And I like how the writers balance this out with quiet moments of contemplation, supported by the game's incredibly patient editing style. And that is the main intention behind this unconventional story structure, to make the player contemplate.
I'll go into greater depth about structure in the cinematic Unpleasure section, but for now, I'll say that if there's one thematic idea that is solely addressed by the structure, it is the idea of otherness.
To quote film scholars Heidi Kay and IQ Hunter, when our sense of self becomes shaky, we attempt to reconstruct an other from which to distinguish ourselves in binary opposition. The notion of identity tends to be exclusive rather than inclusive. Part 2's story asks us to deconstruct the other we spent 10 hours building against Abby, and once we return to Ellie with a greater understanding of Abby, we have to identify why Ellie upholds this otherness and contemplate how it affected the player when we aligned our thirst for revenge with hers. Even after it's all over, Ellie never learns the true reason as to why Abby killed Joel. They never take the opportunity to understand each other, and Ellie is left to believe that Joel died because he saved her, not because of his destructive actions.
I know why you killed Joel. He did what he did to save me. There is no cure because of me. I am the one that you want.
But some players didn't want to deconstruct their otherness. Some players felt alienated in how they couldn't identify with such a beloved character, and the writers seemingly expected that degree of cognitive dissonance.
For this game, we said if you don't buy into Abby's journey and why she's done what she's done and the relationship she has with the characters, then this game falls apart. And admittedly, right, for some people it does.
And it's understandable if you don't like this type of storytelling.
It is rare for a media product to tackle this idea because you're essentially asking the customer to reevaluate their beliefs, which can and has greatly affected sales.
Sometimes. Unlike the first game, there is no linear path we follow across America. We are instead transported to a desolate Seattle as we uncover the brutal history of this former quarantine zone. And in Part 2's deviation from a linear narrative, there is a greater sense of boundlessness as we traverse this murky world. This boundlessness alludes to Part 2's subversion of the conventional three-act structure in favour of a development in perspective that we are invited to partake in.
One of the things we want to do with the story is, one, kind of blow up the structure of a traditional classical story. Like, the first game is very much a three-act structure.
Quick side note, I've never seen a piece of media integrate the trailer into part of the narrative like this, while adding another character element upon revisiting the scene which feels a decision of the protagonist. It's something that can only be attempted by a popular media product like The Last of Us, with the moment still able to provoke a reaction without prior knowledge. World building was an important element of the original game. Exploration was encouraged through needing supplies for your character, which was accompanied by letters and hidden conversations with your companion. And this was something Naughty Dog wanted to emphasize in Part 2, originally looking into making the game an open world experience.
Initially, this game was going to be open world with several different hubs.
The first like 3 weeks of my time at Naughty Dog were just like, can we make it open world? And like trying to make that work and then realizing how much it sort of screws with stakes and tension building.
I'm ultimately happy this idea didn't come to fruition, as I find more artistry in creating a boundless world while retaining the structural qualities of a non-linear narrative. I think it was an intentional move to enter Seattle with the largest area of the game, giving the player every opportunity to further explore this world and develop Ellie's relationship with Dina. I found this interesting article about how the game uses imagery and allegory from Israeli politics, with Druckmann himself descending from Israeli heritage. It tries to demonize the content without giving much substance beyond the journalist's opinion, but I like the comparisons between Seattle's checkpoints and the West Bank barriers, a visual motif that was also used for the Boston QZ in the first game. The downtown section sets a precedent for how objective isn't the focus, and that there's a more rewarding experience if you instead focus on exploration. Ellie is set the menial task of finding fuel for a generator to progress her journey, yet the best character-revealing moment is in the music store, where she pauses the objective and sings Take On Me to Dina. This scene can be completely missed, although I doubt many players did, and it is a great example of this game's storytelling approach.
Not everybody has to see it. They'll talk about it. They'll see it later. Whether they're going to see it on YouTube or play again, they'll eventually see it. But I think the fact that you could miss it gives it that much more weight.
If you listen closely, you can hear UMG loading up their double-barreled shotgun in anticipation.
The focus on exploration is ultimately why many players, including myself, felt the game was too long upon their first playthrough. This isn't even plugged in. It's not even a funny joke.
And the most consistent thing that I'm hearing from absolutely everyone is, geez, this game drags. And I think that that feeling comes from the sense that there are so many encounters and so few set pieces for a Naughty Dog game.
Part 2 wants the player to explore and feel the oppressiveness of its world, but the player in control is instead intent on advancing the story, with Hillcrest and Abbey Day 1 being the most prominent examples of the desire for plot revelation. Yet I found that with each subsequent playthrough, these sections have felt less tedious as I place more emphasis on exploring this broken world, aided by the game narratively rewarding you for replaying.
Her sister, though, I was shocked.
Your poor mother.
She should have sensed that something was off, though.
But how does the world building thematically tie into the narrative? Why would they choose to elongate sections that focus on exploration in risk of agitating players who are more invested in the story? I believe it was to highlight the idea that it's the journey that's destructive, not the destination. Come on, I'll fight anyone.
This is seen in the presentation of character, as Abby's attempt to make amends in caring for two disavowed Seraphite adolescents does little to mend the fractured relationship between her, Mel, and Owen.
Isaac's top scar killer suddenly had a change of heart. Nothing to do with Owen, right?
It is seen in the presentation of story, as we never learn who wins the battle between the WLF and Seraphites, with the death and chaos given the most attention, only to later learn there's been heavy casualties on both sides. But most notably, it is seen in the presentation of the ending.
Come back!
Despite Ellie's choice not to kill Abby, and ironically saving her from the pillars in re-embarking on her revenge quest, she ends the game alone, returning to the farmhouse to find an absent Dina and JJ with all her possessions shoved into a room. This is obviously not a satisfying ending for a character most of the audience deeply care about, while also being a subversion of traditional storytelling where the destructive character, who is often an anti-hero, is redeemed if they don't complete their destructive quest. But unlike those stories, Ellie's journey to find Abby is a journey centered around her need to overcome trauma, and her decision to spare Abby is the start of her road to redemption. This conclusion is obviously pessimistic. She's unable to play Joel's guitar, their sad music, the cinematography mimics the riding off into the sunset trope despite the protagonist not completing their character arc. It's just so depressing. Or is it? The final conclusion for a journey of destruction is not Ellie's towards Abby's, it is Ellie's towards Joel's, as within the final flashback she admits she's ready to forgive his actions from the end of the first game. The positioning of this flashback is important too, It doesn't come immediately after sparing Abby and realizing her destructive journey was a mistake. It comes after her trek back across America, where she's had time to reflect on her actions, where she's had time to reflect on her feelings towards Dina and JJ. Placing Joel's conclusion after this moment offers some hope that Dina will be able to forgive Ellie in time, which is also symbolized in Ellie's bracelet, but pretend I haven't mentioned that just yet. Her final actions are to put the guitar to one side, a symbolic item of her need to honor Joel's memory, and slowly leave the abandoned farmhouse, which I perceive as her returning to Jackson to rekindle Dina's relationship. This was the original intention of the writers, but like a lot of the story beats, they wanted the idea to be left to interpretation.
Hallie wrote a draft of that scene, and it had Ellie picking up one of JJ's toys, the one that was on the tractor, and she puts in her backpack and then she leaves. And I felt like, you know what, that's answering it too much.
This is also why I don't buy into the theory that Ellie has already reunited with Dina before the final scene, but ultimately your perception of the ending will be based on how you construe the events and tone of the game.
I've seen criticism online that the game is too dark and that humanity would band together in a crisis rather than turn into factions and into violence. What?
They're starting to throw Molotov cocktails. We're going.
While the tone of the protagonist may have shifted, the tone of the world has not. You just have to look through the rubble to find its soulfulness.
Ellie, like, she still maintains the goodness that exists within her. And then what she does with that.
I think we should maintain this positivity by talking about a character that isn't outwardly suffering from depression. Dina
primarily acts as a counterpart to Ellie, manifesting the goodness we saw in her from the original game. I see her as a representation of what Ellie would have been like if she overcame trauma, with Dina having to overcome the loss of her sister before the events of part two.
We're not sitting here saying there's one universal way people experience trauma. We're just saying this is how Ellie did it. But look, here's Dina, and she's still capable of putting her family first and being present, and she gets to bring out the love and the sweetness that we saw in Ellie from the first game.
Dina provides the warmth Ellie has lost in the death of Joel, demonstrated when they reunite with Jesse at the theater. From the offset, it may appear that Ellie resents Jesse for coming as she ominously watches Dina care for her wounded ex-boyfriend. However, her diary later reveals she's glad Jesse came to Seattle. Upon review of this scene, we realize Ellie's reaction is characteristic of her struggle with connection, with this moment reminding her of the time she lost with Joel. Dina is able to complete Ellie for a while, unequivocally supporting her rampage of revenge while nurturing the pain Ellie carries, but their relationship doesn't last. Ellie's decision to leave her idyllic lifestyle disassociated a lot of players because of its irrationality. But I think the game's presentation of the farmhouse sequence was integral to understanding Ellie's trauma, in that it's not the lifestyle that will allow her to overcome trauma, it's the interior journey she needs to complete. Dina isn't able to accommodate Ellie's trauma because it differentiates from the way she dealt with trauma, believing Ellie goes to Santa Barbara for an altruistic mission on behalf of Tommy.
You don't owe Tommy anything.
And because Dina isn't enough for Ellie, she doesn't become enough for the participant playing as Ellie, which is why I believe she's received a mixed reception despite her injection of occasionally needed vivacity.
Dina sucks!
She does suck.
She's
I don't like
so
Dina, but
boring.
Loves her! But Ellie loves her! I don't love her, but Ellie, I don't even know that I buy that she loves him.
Dina ties her personality to Ellie in a stronger way than any other character, which builds up to an ending where she breaks away from Ellie and leaves the memory of her at the farmhouse. This coincides with Ellie coming to terms with her trauma, the thing that fractured their relationship. Once the trauma is conquered, she tries to return to that idyllic lifestyle, only to find that life has already gone. It's a subtle but powerful move on behalf of Dina to progress from a passive protector of Ellie to an active character that will not wait for her lover like the traditional heroine. She doesn't leave a note, and the only possession Ellie has of hers is the bracelet. At the beginning of day two, Dina gives Ellie a bracelet interweaved with a hamster amulet, which she wears all throughout Seattle. Yet it becomes notably absent during the farmhouse scenes. However, the hamster symbol is present on their wall.
I don't need to tell you that this might symbolize Ellie's gradual distancing from their relationship.
The bracelet remains missing all throughout Santa Barbara, but finally reappears upon Ellie's return to the farmhouse. The choice to wear it at the end says to me that Ellie is ready to acknowledge and move on from her mistakes. While she cannot atone for the people she's killed, she can make amends for the relationship she destroyed. She can recoup a partner that, as previously mentioned, completed her character. I also think this suggests that Dina would have been enough for Ellie if she hadn't been consumed by grief, while symbolizing the positive effect she had in subduing that grief for a time. If that's sounding like the description of another character, you're not wrong, but it isn't the other pregnant woman.
I don't want to fight over land that I don't give a f*** about anymore.
Owen is a sometimes charismatic voice of reason that, outside of dictating the room during Joel's death, has little active status in the story. Unlike Dina, Owen's relationship with Abby broke down because of his role in her trauma, instead of the trauma itself. As Owen was present upon Abby finding her dead father, he becomes a reminder of Joel's actions and a symbol of her trauma. In one flashback, we see her reject spending time with him because it coincides with training.
I know all the leads have dried up, but Joel's still out there, you know?
I know. What can I do?
Let's go back. We can still make training.
To Abby, Owen becomes a prize for overcoming her trauma, which she believes can be won in cold-blooded murder. Hey, I know somebody else like that. This doesn't work, and her goal is further complicated by Owen finding another partner and sealing the relationship through pregnancy, which Abby reacts to by pushing on with her revenge quest alone. This further feeds into the point I made earlier about the journey being destructive and not the destination, with Abby already losing Owen before they made it to Jackson.
Sure, they'll be happy to offer that information up.
Well, then we make them.
Do you hear yourself?
Fast forward to Seattle. We see Joel's death hasn't improved Abby's well-being and has driven a wedge between Owen and Mel, stemming from her inhumane actions in Jackson. Abby is still unable to process her feelings after Joel's death. She travels across Seattle to find Owen in fear he might be in danger, but contradicts herself in finding no desire in finally being with him, realizing he won't cure the nightmares of her father. Her quest to rekindle their relationship ends disappointingly, and similar to Dina, he becomes disappointing to the player who should be beginning to identify with Abby. Although it's worth noting he's popular within the fandom, but not so much among the mass player base. There is the added factor that this likable personality with genuine concerns about rehabilitation then commits adultery upon having his epiphany. Owen is one of the most complicated characters in Part 2. He wants to do right by the world, but struggles with his own moral desires. An intentional conflict on the part of the writers, who I perceive to be commenting on the limits of altruism in a world where you have to prioritize self-preservation. Similar to another game that came out a while back. I think it got okay reviews. This isn't to say Abby doesn't like Owen, despite her disapproval of him in the latter days. It's important to consider Abby's trait of showing minimal affection, even when they were in a stable relationship.
And he makes you laugh.
That's because he's such an idiot.
Abby realizes she needs to overcome her trauma to stop having nightmares, which she had to do through caring for Yara and Lev. Even upon Owen's death triggering her tendencies for violence, her new purpose triumphs and prevents the facilitation of further violence. Parallel to Ellie's journey, she remembers her last conversation as an argument, yet she's able to overcome the pain while Ellie's memory causes further suffering. Lev makes Abby comfortable with her pain, where she is more open about showing the influence Owen had on her personality. We only get a small glimpse of this near the end of the game, as Ellie finds a letter on Abby's boat where she openly talks about the loss she's experienced, something we've not seen her do up until this point. I believe this letter is one of the most important collectibles to understanding Abby, because it uncovers what she was too scared to say all along, while also highlighting how Ellie still hasn't come to terms with her trauma, something that confines both protagonists in part two. Trauma is the most prominent theme of part two. Contrary to some reviewers, I don't believe mindless revenge to be the causality of Ellie and Abby's decision-making, as trauma is present throughout the whole game and not just in Ellie's half. But don't just take my word. What does the boss man have to say for himself?
But I think ultimately we start from theme more than anything else. So trauma and redemption and trying to make sure that, the cyclical nature of violence is pervasive in every facet of the game and every character.
Continuing with discussion on Abby, it becomes progressively clearer that her imposing physical stature is a juxtaposition to her emotional vulnerability. There's a beautiful smash cut that reflects her interior feelings at the moment of Joel's death in her first section. We see Abby constantly being vulnerable, waking up from a nightmare in her introduction while her friends motionlessly sleep in half-covered body bags, a subtle hint for the fate that awaits them. During Seattle, we see that she finds pride in her strength, but only in how it masks her trauma, unlike Ellie, who is more open about the repercussions of Joel's death, it being the driving force of her vendetta. This difference is dependent on how their trauma has developed, with Abby already understanding that revenge won't allow her to overcome it. Instead, she has to invoke something even more fundamental to humanity, love. The same love that allowed Joel to overcome his trauma.
I'm like, okay, here's someone that has carried it through and has meant nothing to them and hasn't fulfilled their hole that's been left. How do they come back from that? And it's like, okay, what if they were able to connect with someone that they've been at war with?
Off a chance meeting, Lev helps Abby overcome her fears, which then allows her to overcome her trauma. During the journey to the hospital, she is guided across skyscrapers by him, something which terrifies Abby as heights are shown to be her primary irrational fear. In being forced to face and conquer her fears, she now attaches her bravery to Lev in a similar way to how she attaches her trauma to Owen. This attachment means she is able to face her trauma, allowing herself to love somebody without the fear of loss eclipsing her feelings. She needed Lev to make herself feel whole again, similar to how Joel would sacrifice everything if it meant he got to keep Ellie. Here, The Last of Us is stating that you must embrace fear to deal with trauma, which is embodied in the surrogate children these characters care for. Lev, like a young Ellie, is characterized by his fearlessness, rebelling against the authoritarian regime he was indoctrinated into, and facing his fears if it means saving somebody he cares about.
Heights never scared me. What does? The ocean? Lev! Get back here! Lev!
He serves as the perfect complementary character to Abby, who physically and mentally defines herself by her fear and trauma. This is the hardest part of the game to discuss, because it taps into an emotion that humans aren't particularly good at comprehending. Anyone who's experienced loss will know that you can't quantify or predict a response. There is no universality in the pain of loss, and that is what The Last of Us explores.
Another way to look at Joel, Ellie, and Abby as these three characters and their arcs is they're all struggling with quieting their demons. They're all suffering from their own version of trauma, and how do they get past it?
When it comes to Ellie, I perceive her character to be going through less of an identity crisis without Joel, and more struggling with the trauma of how their relationship ended. Ellie does some reprehensible things in trying to find meaning in her trauma, which tests the player in how far they can empathize with a character they loved from the first game. We have to eventually accept she isn't that hopeful 14-year-old girl anymore. To expect that would be a desire from the player that ignores the trauma she's endured. not only from Joel's death, which acts as an inciting incident for the narrative, but from something that harkens back to the first game, her immunity. Part 2's opening establishes two important aspects, one being there is no ambiguity in if the Fireflies would have developed a vaccine, or that the hope of creating a vaccine was a morally justifiable reason to allow her to die, something fans have cited in defending Joel's actions, and the other being Ellie's inconclusive feelings about her immunity.
She needed her immunity to mean something. I told her. Her immunity meant nothing.
This latter element is what ends up causing friction between Joel and Ellie. Because Ellie never came to terms with her immunity, she never came to terms with her relationship with Joel. Once she finds out Joel disregards any meaning her immunity has, she disregards the thing he values most, their relationship. Only when her relationship with Dina begins to form, giving Ellie another purpose other than her immunity, is when she can find the courage to begin to forgive him. Chronologically, she shows a stronger sense in her immunity after this moment, demonstrated in the time she weaponizes it during and post-Seattle, carrying a similar sensibility to her escape from David in the first game. The way her immunity arc concludes falls in line with The Last of Us's dog-eat-dog attitude when humanity's survival is tested, boiling her life-saving ability down to another tool that can overpower her enemies. But despite the lives it could have saved, it can't bring back the people she's lost. Her trauma stems not only from the loss of Joel, but the time she lost with Joel, perceiving her revenge quest as a time where she can recuperate her bond with him, feeling guilty that she didn't embrace his love during his final days. This reconnection is most apparent in the moments where she tries to replicate him.
Now you're gonna mark it on the map, and it better be the same exact spot your buddy points to.
Point to where she is on this map, and then you... it better f***ing match up.
Part of Ellie's journey is learning that she isn't like Joel, evident in wearing his jacket when she leaves Dina, and best demonstrated in her interrogation of Nora. The setup here is Ellie wants to find Abby, and it's hinted in an overheard conversation that Nora knows where she is. Most players will be eager to torture her.
Yeah, that little bitch got what he deserved.
Coupled with a chase sequence building anticipation for her capture. Yet Ellie is shaken from her actions, actions that are intentionally withheld from the player so they don't question her morality until this moment. Despite Ellie retrieving the information she wanted, this becomes the first moment where she realizes she isn't like Joel.
Her ego is wrapped up in this thing in a way that she doesn't know how to decouple it, which is very different from Joel. Joel's violence is very practical and is almost emotionless.
This moment is followed by the reveal at St. Mary's Hospital where Ellie confirms Joel's lie, highlighting their difference in responding to what they believe is necessary violence, while showing Ellie has come to terms with his approach to violence by Seattle.
Moments like these are why the game is more rewarding on a second playthrough, because we're able to piece together the non-linear narrative and understand the opaque characterization of Ellie and Abby, while better considering the symbolism of reoccurring motifs, such as the guitar.
The guitar is used as a visual representation for Ellie's fading connection with Joel.
If I ever were to lose you,
a lot of people have stated that Ellie loses her connection with Joel once she loses her fingers, stopping her from playing the guitar. And it's a fair interpretation, considering the clear regret she shows for going to Santa Barbara. But I think it negates how her final flashback is about rebuilding a connection with Joel, which is triggered by a moment where she doubts that connection. I think this moment is instead her realizing she doesn't need to honor Joel's memory through a vendetta she has believed will bring her closer to him, as she has another symbol of Joel's that she will always carry, the moth. It's quite hard to make out, but the moth that opens and closes the game is also tattooed onto Ellie's arm, with the writers confirming that Ellie got the idea for her tattoo from the guitar.
It really became to symbolize, for me, this relationship, this connection that she has to Joel, even once he's gone.
This means that while the guitar is obsolete by the end, Joel's connection to Ellie is not. His memory is imprinted onto Ellie, and even though she walks away from the self-serving need to redeem him, the journey, like the tattoo, are scarred on her forever. To finally bring it back to her immunity, the tattoo hides the sign of Ellie's condition, something Joel strode to keep a secret in order to protect her.
I think I see a way through, but we got spores. Put your mask on.
Ugh, do I have to? It's just us.
What if we run into someone?
No matter how pessimistic you interpret the ending to part two, you can take solace in that Joel's legacy still protects Ellie after he's gone. Great, can we get back to something more lighthearted now? No? Okay.
I don't need your f***ing help, Joel.
Before discussing the cycle of violence in part two, I think it's important to mention the prevalence of ludonarrative dissonance. In an interview with Rolling Stone, Druckmann states, "We don't buy into it" when discussing Uncharted 4. There's even a trophy with the same title if you kill 1,000 people. Similar to Nathan Drake, Ellie doesn't react to much of her in-game killing, but unlike the Uncharted series, this isn't attempting to be a stylized reality where conflicts are lighter. There are even suggestions that ludonarrative dissonance was acknowledged by the writers in part two. The final group you kill are irredeemably bad slave masters, where their lack of humanity is one of the few absolutes of the game. Justifying their murder is easy before you contemplate the nature of Ellie's violence in sparing Abby 10 minutes later. Some theorists would compromise on this idea, it being developed upon analyzing one of the most celebrated games of all time. But I am not one of those people because I interpret something different.
Yes, the cycle of violence has been cited by the creators on multiple occasions, so I should be playing my Death of the Author card, which is a valid critical theory for the discussion around content. For this section, I should be stating that we should reevaluate the theme of the cycle of violence and justify why part two is instead commenting on the cycle of protection.
I don't need your f***ing help, Joel.
In Druckmann's first interview after part two was announced, he said this now infamous quote, which suggested a new direction.
If the first game was really like the core of it, the theme was about the love between these two characters, this story is the counter of that. This story is about hate.
However, Druckmann said this before they'd even started filming on part two, and it's reasonable to assume the thematic intentions shifted during the creative process, evidenced when listening to his interviews after release.
You know, when we first started talking about this game, I said, you know, the first game's about love, this game's about hate. That's not true. Both games are about love. Some of the worst atrocities that happen in the world happen in the name of love.
This is why I don't think the cycle of violence is the right term to use here. The game isn't about exploring the fundamental nature of violence, it's exploring the cause of inflicted violence, both on the individual and the people surrounding them. For example, there is a lack of emphasis on how complicit Abby is for violence, despite it being a defining trait and the main thing her trauma gives her. Examining Isaac's death, I believe that if this game were strictly about violence, then Abby would be the one killing him in a rebellious action against her indoctrination into the marginalized beliefs about the Seraphites. Yet we instead see her lay down her weapon and try to protect Lev from violence. Isaac's killing then comes from Yara, somebody who's already consigned to death, with her last action being to protect her brother.
But that's only a single moment in a 25-hour game. How does the narrative trajectory actually feed into this idea? Well, unsurprisingly, it's a continuation of the first game.
What? Nah, I never knew that.
Joel hardens after the killing of Sarah, only to find Ellie, which recaptures the love he possessed pre-outbreak. This is mirrored by Abby, who toughens up after the killing of her father, gains little comfort in her violence, which includes enacting revenge on Joel, to then find Lev, which brings a warmth back into her life and allows her to overcome the pain. I wouldn't say these cycles are continuous, but instead feed into another person's journey. Joel's characterization in part 2 is very static because he had already completed his cycle. His protection of Ellie had violated the protection Abby felt, ending with a demise that he willfully accepts.
Why don't you say whatever speech you got rehearsed? Get this over with.
These characters struggle with the journey because attachment in this world is associated with the loss of power. Or as Bill puts it,
and in this world, that sort of shit's good for one thing, getting you killed.
Their power of protection is debilitated as they relearn love, seen in how they lose battles against adversaries that they previously would have won or averted. This is a pessimistic attribute of The Last of Us that goes relatively unnoticed by players because it's balanced out by the idea that life isn't worth living without attachment.
I struggled for a long time with surviving. And you, no matter what, you keep finding something to fight for.
The player aligns with Ellie in Abby's brutal violation of the protection we felt from Joel. This allows us to later understand Ellie's trauma, with Abby taking away the chance Ellie had to mend her broken relationship with Joel, which dictates our collectively fractured psyche more than Dina, Tommy, or Jesse ever could. Abby becomes emblematic of how Ellie's protection can be violated at any moment. And that's why she couldn't let go of her hate.
Me, what became more and more clear is that obsession will cost you everything. Mm-hmm. And even Joel heralds that in the very, very beginning, where he says there was a cost.
Abby is an ineradicable part of Ellie's life in the months following Seattle. Their newborn boy is named after Joel and Jesse, two people loved by the couple whose lives were taken by her. Ellie feels her endeavor is honoring Joel's memory, but Joel would have never wanted Ellie to endanger herself for him. He prioritized the protection of those he loved, demonstrated in how quickly he intervenes at the barn, even though Ellie hasn't spoken to him in months. This is what Tommy tries to tell Ellie at the beginning, but their hate only leads to irrationality.
If it were you or me, Joel would be halfway to Seattle already.
No, he wouldn't.
He absolutely would be.
There is no honor found in retribution, with Ellie furious at Joel for being disingenuous, even though she later does the same thing to achieve her own selfish goal.
But I can't just leave Tommy. He's out here because of me. He can take care of himself.
Jesus Christ.
The best way to help Tommy is to go after Abby.
But there is pride in the selfless protection of others, which we see in Abby's arc. Look at the framing when Abby kills the Ronda Rousey Seraphite, her strength on full display as a tired Lev and Yara walk into shot. The cycle of protection turning as these characters begin to realize how much stronger they are as a unit. This development culminates when Abby reaches Lev and Yara's former hut, finding a scared and wounded Lev alone in the corner. While Yara comforts her brother, Abby picks up his bow and hands it to him with few words spoken, symbolic of the protection he requires. The moment is reminiscent of Joel and Ellie's relationship in the post-Pittsburgh stages of the first game. I believe this is when Abby comes full circle, with the on-the-nose "you're my people" moment confirming her standing to the audience. The different points Ellie and Abby are situated on this cycle complement each other in the interwoven narrative, and deconstructing this cycle allows you to understand the unspoken reasoning of the decisions the protagonists make. During my first playthrough, I thought the game would end after Ellie's panic attack at the farmhouse, complemented by a rare wide shot of the two characters before cutting to black. But perpetual trauma is not where the cycle ends. It is what fuels the cycle. It was inevitable Ellie would hunt Abby again because she lacks that feeling of protection in her idyllic lifestyle. Tommy just gives her the information to facilitate her mission. The look Ellie has as he discloses the information shows she knew straight away that she'll leave to find her, mixed with the sad realization this will cost her relationship with Dina. It's only after Dina rejects his proposal that her expression changes. The cycle of protection is problematic because it is advanced by violence and trauma before achieving a sense of love. This feeds into the theme of tribalism that I haven't touched on because it's quite self-explanatory and isn't as prevalent as the themes discussed. But Ellie's cycle is unique because without finding somebody she can care for, as opposed to being cared by Dina, she has the possibility to fall into a much deeper chasm of interior emptiness. By sparing Abby and perceived to be ending with nothing, she can begin to move on with her obsession. As we see with Abby, killing Joel didn't end her nightmares and instead costed her more. In Ellie's realization of her destructive journey, she not only saves Abby and herself, but the kid she also threatened as a byproduct of her destruction, with the suggestion being that Lev would be subject to the cycle of protection and seek revenge on Ellie, if he was to survive.
How right you should kill with a knife.
There is the sense that the cycle of protection is over for these characters, now that Ellie has broken away from its destructive nature.
Oh. Just take him.
Even though the game carries a feeling of circularity in its opening and closing shots, we are left to consider the repercussions for Ellie as she searches for a new purpose to fight for.
I'm not going to stop the wheel. I'm going to break the wheel.
No, this is not the cinematic unpleasure that comes with watching Cats or any of my old films. This is a cinematic technique where the audience is invited to question why a piece of media makes them uncomfortable, therefore drawing greater meaning from the text. This is often achieved by refuting an audience member, or in this case a participant, their desire for satisfaction. To quote film theorist Catherine Wheatley, as unpleasure calls attention to itself in a way that pleasure does not, it prompts the viewer to question what it is in the film that causes this feeling, and hence forces them to engage rationally with the image on screen. You can see this utilized in most of Darren Aronofsky's films. They're brutal to watch, but the brutality is put into the context of narrative and theme. In Requiem for a Dream, the characters descend into a drug-fueled coma of chaos, and we can infer that the message is, oh, drugs are bad. In Mother, there is a violent and bleak portrayal of events straight from the Bible, and we can infer that, oh, Aronofsky wrote this in 2 days. But Part 2's deconstruction is more complicated than those examples, not because of the message itself, but because it's codified in a surface-level story which you must first overcome.
Revenge is a bad feeling. It's bad energy. It should be something different.
Anger?
This has been the source of the most confusion, not helped by these, about the game's message. If the game worked for you, then you will already know the writers hid the experience of relearning empathy behind a story of revenge that evolves into a complex evaluation of character and player identity. I believe this is why the writers didn't take the seemingly obvious option of Ellie and Abby's story having greater narrative connection. The game wants you to realize you've been deceived, to draw on the unpleasure that comes with initially playing as Abby. Our vengeance manifests because of how little we know about her, being left cold for 12 hours with nothing more than a name, face, and an act of hate. This revenge motivates us on a first playthrough when we don't fully understand Ellie's motivation, reaching a crescendo in the theater confrontation before, bam, cut to black. Okay, now play as Abby for the next 10 hours. Not only that, but the first part of Abby's story is slow, further provoking the player. I thought the same thing on my first playthrough. I've achieved all these weapon upgrades for Ellie, and now you want me to repeat the whole process again? God damn it, Naughty Dog, I'm fuming. And if my frustration here or elsewhere online proves anything, it is that the cinematic unpleasure being utilized here works. Abby Day 1 is the most prominent use of this technique, because it is the time when we need to question the way we feel about the characters the most. to question our hatred towards Abby, with the first few hours progressing like the player doesn't have any discontent for her. This is coupled with how passive Abby is in her own story. Her first active action that has any consequence is saving Yara at the end of day one, a moment highlighted in this one-take cutscene that serves as the point many players' perception of her changed, as our identity can finally align with Abby's in the mission of saving these children. This approach to storytelling is unconventional, even outside of the mainstream media space. There's been a claim that this story fundamentally doesn't work because it combats against dramatic structure, in particular the rising action aspect. Rising action essentially states that after the inciting incident, the conflict needs to continually develop to a climax situated near the end of the story. Now, this would be true for a plot-driven story, which most American mainstream media is. However, this is not applicable for a character-driven story, the category Part 2 falls into. What character-driven narratives often do is intentionally subvert and challenge the arc of story so we can contemplate the arc of character. Here's some of my favorite examples. For Part 2, dramatic structure is subverted so the audience focuses more on the character narrative, which has a clear arc across both protagonists. Ellie's arc is centered around her fall into damnation after her turbulent relationship with Joel is fragmented. The character switch comes at Ellie's low point, her destruction costing Jesse's life with Tommy and her own at stake. We then follow Abby, whose arc is about rekindling emotion and therefore the player's empathy as she grows to care for two disavowed Seraphites. This climaxes in a heated theater confrontation where Abby can let go of her hate and spare Ellie. Defying expectations, the final switchback is not where the story ends, as we realize Seattle didn't halt Ellie's psychological descent. It's only upon refuting the opportunity to kill Abby that she can begin to mend her fractured spirit. Separately, each character arc looks like this, but together they create this roller coaster of emotion that utilizes how we identify with video game protagonists differently compared to other mediums, controlling their actions but not their character. Wisecrack made a great video discussing the commentary Part 2 has on utilizing empathy and identification as a tool for manipulation. To summarize their conclusion, the game, particularly the sections where you play as Abby, forces us to rethink our conception
of empathy.
With Part 2's story about empathy comes the lesson of forgiveness and the challenge on our capability to forgive somebody who is gradually brought into our tribe. By making Abby more difficult to forgive, you're able to better understand the message of empathy and why it's important.
No, I also think if we were to have done what Lucy's suggesting, it would have made everything easier in a way that, like, then you're not really reflecting on Joel. You're also not really reflecting on who Ellie will become. Like, by mitigating Abby, it lets everybody else off the hook.
Part 2's most extreme usage of cinematic unpleasure comes in the two confrontations, forcing you to punish Ellie for her actions while playing as Abby, then shifting perspective in the climax where Abby is punished for actions that, like Joel, she has come to terms with. These two moments of confrontation relate back to the point Wheatley makes and force the player to contemplate the danger of tribalism.
Even early on, like, the idea was like, make it feel pathetic, make it feel disgusting, make you not want to participate.
It's worth noting that even players who realized the unpleasure was commenting on empathy still felt Ellie was obliged to kill Abby.
Now, when this happened, I went, what the f-? I felt robbed. Even though I no longer wanted to kill Abby, it seemed like that was the inevitable conclusion to this story.
Because the biggest challenge of the climax is not to continually press square, it is to decouple our institutionalized sense of tribalism.
And the results have varied from person to person because there is no difficulty setting in the game or in life to make forgiving someone easier.
Part 2 then elevates the use of cinematic unpleasure by emphasizing the consequence of action outside the narrative's boundaries. To quote Wheatley again, so often the genre ends with the defeat of the villain, with no indication of how the surviving protagonist will be affected by the events they have endured, which may include losing loved ones. This realistically was never going to be an issue for Part 2, when one of its core themes was trauma, and discussion of the ending online has long already been theorizing how Part 3 will be affected by it. Requiem for a Dream aside, media products that utilize cinematic unpleasure are almost always divisive, because they reject the idea of a product as entertainment, the primary reason most customers will consume the media. If you've experienced and like all the products I'm showing on screen, then you're probably a masochist because they each mobilize a different axis of cinematic unpleasure.
I do, however, think that the interaction of video games are an innovative way to use this cinematic technique because the player has the opportunity to search for the pleasure they crave, to find another note that extends the world just a little bit more.
The fact that so many character-revealing moments in Part 2 aren't things every player will see gives them more weight when they are finally discovered. It forces the player to give more of themselves to the game if they want to be fulfilled by the experience. And people have found a satisfaction in the product of Part 2 in vastly different ways, some in reflecting on the text, and others by exploiting the text.
So let's talk about that.
No, not like that.
You're infuriating.
If your father ever tells you that you're a failure at life, you can tell that toothless that at least I didn't make The Last of Us 2!
To quote post-structuralism theorist Roland Barthes, there is one place where this multiplicity is focused, and that place is the reader, not the author. A text's unity lies not in its origin, but in its destination. Hashtag perspective matters.
This philosophy is ultimately why there is a lack of interconnectedness in finding agreement for Part 2, exemplified by the two subreddits that only serve to exacerbate this problem.
For example, when I think about Abby, I think of a struggling individual whose lesson of understanding empathy reveals just as much about the player's psyche as it does her own.
Why did you come back for us?
Guilt.
Of what? You don't owe us anything.
I just needed to lighten the load a bit.
When the writers think about Abby, they imagine a fragmented shell of a person who unintentionally embarks on a mission to recapture her humanity.
And I think the trap we could have fallen into is, oh, we want you to like Abby, so let's make her perfect in every single way. Instead, we lean into her flaws, and we try to find the humanity within that for all these characters.
But other credible content creators see a character who's defined by a traumatizing action that she must face a consequence for.
It's because Abby is a poorly handled, unlikable character. And with Abby, do I even need to explain why she's unlikable?
This proves that similar to the characters in Part 2, discourse struggles to find perspective. Not only perspective in opinion, but also the perspective in perspective. What does PewDiePie's Let's Play of Part 2 that consistently accentuates his dislike of the game and Cosmonaut's video with a very loaded title have in common? It's that they basically scored Part 2 the same.
Part of me wants to give it a 6, and part of me wants to give it a 7.
Give it a rating? Probably like a 6 out of 10. I don't know. I didn't hate it.
Now, while you shouldn't put much stock on review scores that have progressively become more of a marketing technique than a reviewer's representation of opinion, I bring this up to show we're all on a spectrum of how much we like this game, and there is an inevitable perplexity with where we situate other people on it. I understand why people don't like Part 2. It requires a lot from the player and asks them to have a certain mindset about the narrative's presentation, which frankly isn't why a lot of people choose to play video games, or even the first Last of Us for that matter. But what I don't understand are people who hate this game without even playing it.
Now, while it is true that I haven't tested out the gameplay of The Last of Us Part 2, I did take the time to watch the cutscenes.
Hello friends, it's me. Today we're gonna be checking out some of the dumbest people on the internet.
Besides the fact you shouldn't do this, like you shouldn't review The Irishman after watching it on a microwave, You engage differently with a character when you control them, something that Part 2 is aware of and integrates into the experience. The focus on exploration is something you can better realize by playing the game, but that, along with thematic intention, got totally undermined by the leaks. I'm not going to discuss the reaction to the leaks, as I'm only interested in analysing content or people's reaction to content from the game.
Plus, there isn't much to say other than Sony, not Naughty Dog, wrongfully filed DMCA strikes against creators discussing them, further feeding into the outrage.
The love that people have for this character, and that's all they have, is that, and then you play the person that killed him, and they lose their understandably. And they just live with that frustration and anger.
The leaks are believed to have either come from hackers or a disgruntled employee at Naughty Dog. Neither of these claims have been verified, but it's important to consider that Naughty Dog benefits by saying it was a hacker, and people trying to demonize the game benefit by saying it was an employee. Amidst all this, the working conditions at Naughty Dog have been subject for a wider discussion around crunch culture in the video game industry. While that subject could be a whole video itself, I recommend you read this article by Jason Schreier and formulate your own opinion. In regard to director Neil Druckmann, the mobilized hate that rallied against him quickly forgot about his previous successes as a director and formed a witch hunt that is blatantly unethical and has been used by some creators as a way to facilitate their careers.
Fellas, I know that I just made a Last of Us 2 video, but I'm sorry, this post right here was like a golf club to the back of my head.
And before you incite the freedom of speech argument, note that the mobilized hate has stopped creators from honestly sharing their praise for Part 2 in fear of backlash, opting for a more neutral approach, which has in turn fed this narrative of hatred. Seeing comments like this doesn't give me the feeling that freedom of speech is protecting voices.
At least a valuable lesson was learned about online polls, and this was the first and last mistake ever made with them.
I would split the response to Part 2 into three categories. People who liked the game, people who didn't like the game, and people who didn't play the game. Come on, it's a joke. The earliest video I found criticizing Part 2 having played the game was SkillUp's review. Like many of his reviews, it focuses primarily on gameplay, and because it came out pre-embargo lift, doesn't delve deep into story. But he mentions the reasons why he didn't like it. This video is good. I don't agree with some of his points, but he articulates himself in an eloquent and appropriate way. I particularly like his conclusion that the first game is like a
work of a Spielberg. The Last of Us 2 feels like the work of a Francis Ford Coppola or Oliver Stone. Something starker, more divisive, made to be mulled over and contemplated.
Even if he says it didn't work for him.
I bring this up to clarify that there is valid criticism towards Part 2, something I feel needs to be mentioned because the rest of this video is going to be me criticising some of the scathing early reviews. Likewise, there is valid criticism towards some of the praise of Part 2.
I could reference the comments on IGN's review, but it's just full of 10 out of 10 memes. Some people have drawn comparisons between Part 2 and The Last Jedi, and they share a similar space in Part 2 being a continuation of an outrageous reaction to a divisive text that dares to be postmodern and progressive trend, while also having Last in the title. Although for me, The Last Jedi's main issue was its inconsistent tone, one of the things most people agree Part 2 doesn't suffer from.
And for the record, I love Star Wars and dislike The Last Jedi.
Upon release, there was a plethora of unpolished negative reviews that, intentionally or not, capitalized on the influx of hate that was anticipated by people furious at the leaks, which was then perpetuated by the review bombing on Metacritic. Thankfully, I don't need to analyze all of them because one stands above the rest and hits all the main points that were reiterated. The revised title, outdated, Last of Us 2 Prologue Rant, check out the real review, link in description, is a one-take rant from a player who avoided most of the leaks and stopped playing after Joel died to record the video. It's impulsive, impassioned, and I'm so grateful the creator kept this video up after publishing a full review.
This marks a transition in this video where my script ends, I go back into lockdown hibernation, and I hand over to my creator.
Now, this would be the time where I would analyse Jay's video and talk about the reaction to Joel's death and the claims of false advertisement. But while I was editing this video, he deleted his. And every point I made was in response to a point he made from that video. I do have the video saved. I have recorded everything already. But I don't feel it's right on my part that if he doesn't want the video up and that being a representation of his opinion, then I shouldn't be publicizing that opinion and talking about it. So I might one day upload this section of the video, but for now, you're gonna just have to live. The Last of Us Part 2 is the latest media product in a trend that sees the widening of discourse in a social media age that prioritizes the segmentation of opinion and negates rational discussion. The title of this video pokes fun at the phenomenon, but it is a problem that is becoming more prevalent as social media algorithms evolve.
This game put too much effort into its characters for us to deflect the blame they bear onto ourselves. Our role is not to carry their sins, but to examine how their actions make us feel as we perform them.
I know this title is a bit clickbaity, but there are some great videos on Part 2 out there.
For a positive take, I'd recommend Girlfriend Reviews Understanding The Last of Us Part 2 and Wisecracks The Real Reason Why The Last of Us 2 is So Divisive. For a balanced view, I'd recommend Games as Literature, Is The Last of Us Part 2 a Guilt Trip, and Alana Pierce's Four Journalists vs. The Last of Us 2. She also has another video talking about review scores and confirms the conspiracy that reviewers were paid off is just completely wrong.
Alana, you are awesome.
If you watched this and disagreed with most or all of my points, then I'd recommend Macabre Storytelling's video on Part 2. We may have different interpretations, but I respect his clear knowledge on the subject. If I am to promote a call to action for this video, it wouldn't be to subscribe, but to instead replay Part 2 and see if your perception has changed in the aftermath of its controversy. Social media abhors a vacuum, and I feel it's important that an opinion is shaped by personal experience and not the consumed media opinions of the text.
I'll walk through the valley of the shadow of death, and I fear no evil because I'm blind to it all. In my mind, my gun, they comfort me because I know I'll kill my enemies when they come. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell on this earth forevermore. Said I walk beside the still waters and they restore my soul, but I can't walk on the path of the right because I'm wrong.